Okay, hello everyone. First, let me thank the organizers for this opportunity. Today, Felix and myself will be talking to you about a Bitcommittent experiment we did between Geneva and Singapore. And this is joint work with Tommaso, Raphael, Marco, Adrian, Nicola, Stephanie, and Hugo. And this is not working. Perfect. Okay, so very quickly, a Bitcommittent. So this was already mentioned on Tuesday by Fred. So let me just briefly remind you what a primitive is all about. So the primitive of a Bitcommittent is very simple. There are two phases.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. So should I just use the laptop then? Not really, no. Okay, I'll just use the laptop, it's fine. Okay, anyway, so there are two phases. So there's the commit phase in which Bob commits a bit to Alice, and there's the open phase in which Bob opens his commitment and Alice, you know, decides whether to accept or reject. And the protocol should be, there are three requirements. So the protocol should be correct. So if both parties are honest, then kind of Alice always accepts. The protocol should be binding. So if Alice is honest, then there's at most one bit that Bob can reveal. And it should be hiding. So if Bob is honest, then Alice shouldn't learn anything about his choice before the open phase. Okay, so it's a great primitive, but it's not possible using quantum mechanics, and we know that for quite a while now. So there are impossibility proofs, and these impossibility proofs essentially say that a protocol that's perfectly secure or close to perfectly secure for both parties cannot exist, okay? So there exist protocols that give kind of partial security to each party, but this is not exactly what we want. So the idea is that if you want to evade the no-go theorem, you can do it by imposing communication constraints. And these communication constraints can be motivated or derived by, you know, from special relativity. So you can think, okay, if two things happen at, you know, faraway locations and it's space-like separated, and maybe they cannot communicate. I mean, sounds plausible to me. And this is essentially the idea of relativistic bit commitment. So the brief overview is that the first protocol came out in 99, and this is a fully classical protocol, you know, two sites exchanging some classical information. And a couple of years later, it was improved. And the second protocol is essentially very similar. It just kind of reduces the communication complexity. And then a couple of years later, there were the quantum protocols. So there's the quantum protocol with flying qubits. There's the quantum protocol with, you know, transmitting measurement outcomes. And as you can see, this field is pretty crowded. Quite a few people are working on this. So we decided that maybe there's space for us as well. So there you go. So I'll tell you about the transmitting measurement outcomes protocol. So the protocol is actually very simple. In the commit phase, Alice generates random BB84 states, sends them to Bob, and then Bob now commits. And his commitment is essentially a measurement. So if he wants to commit to a zero, he measures everything in a computational basis. If he wants to commit to a one, he measures everything in the Hadamard basis. So he writes down the classical measurement outcomes. He distributes them to his kind of agents, you know, far away somewhere. And this is the end of the commit phase. Then in the open phase, these agents just pass this information to Alice's agents, who are incidentally standing next to them. And then these agents just verify, okay, is this classical information consistent with the BB84 states that, you know, Alice generated at the beginning? And somehow the intuition why this kind of evades the no-go theorem is because, you know, in the no-go, Bob kind of keeps everything quantum. He delays all his measurements until the end. But in this case, he cannot do it because he kind of needs this information to be present at two points which are far away. And, well, essentially, he's forced to measure, you know, during the commit phase. He cannot delay it. That's kind of the important thing. And okay, and so, I mean, you can prove security of this, and there are proofs, there are papers about this. But obviously, when I say secure, you should ask, okay, what's the kind of the security model? Or more importantly, what is the kind of the minimal assumption that you need for security? And actually, this turns out to be a fairly interesting question. And actually, the minimal assumption is that there are two Bobs in the open phase, okay? So the only thing you actually need is that Alice can challenge two agents of Bob somehow independently such that they cannot collaborate in the open phase. And in this particular model, this is like the kind of the minimal split model, there is a quantum advantage. So actually, it's easy to convince yourself that classically you cannot do anything, but quantumly you can. So that's kind of a nice thing. But anyway, how do you do it relativistically? It's very simple. So you put Alice and Bob in the middle, they exchange some BB84 states, Bob measures, and then he gets the measurement outcomes. He sends them at this, you know, speed of light to his agents who are far away. And then, you know, when they receive it, they just pass it on to Alice. So it's all very simple. Obviously, when you talk about sending things at the speed of light, you might be a bit, you know, dubious, but in principle, it's possible. Okay, so the previous security proofs, they all deal with kind of the idealized scenario. So you have perfect sources, perfect detectors, you know, no noise, no anything. Very nice, but not realistic, okay? Because when we actually did the experiment, we didn't have a single photon source. We used a weak coherent source with phase randomization. So, you know, the density matrix looks like this. There is some kind of mu, the mean photon number, which you can play with. So this should look familiar from the optics tutorial by Marcos. But I mean, essentially, you need kind of to extend the analysis. It's not so straightforward. And the same for kind of for channels, for detectors. There will be bit flip errors. There will be losses. You need to account for that. And so now you think, okay, how does this affect my protocol? And you know, on one hand, noise or losses will make honest Bob more difficult. Honest Bob's life more difficult. So kind of the obvious fix would be, okay, just, you know, make Alice more forgiving. Maybe she will tolerate some losses. Maybe she won't check the whole string, just part of it. And this kind of works, but then obviously cheating becomes easier, right? So that's not what we want. On the other hand, the multi-photon emissions, these are really dangerous, right? Because if Bob receives two photons in the same state, then he can measure one of them in the computational basis, the other one in the Hadamard basis, and he actually obtains both correct outcomes, so then he can cheat perfectly. So then you say, okay, these are really dangerous, let's eliminate them. How do you eliminate them? Well, you have to decrease the mean photon number, you know, play with your source. But then you end up with a lot of vacuum rounds. So then essentially you just emit nothing most of the time. So that's not a lot of fun. I mean, you cannot do much by emitting nothing. So, I mean, you need to try a bit harder, and, you know, a fault tolerant version that we came up with is the following. So, okay, the first phase is the same. So you know, Alice generates these quantum states, but now we think of them as kind of pulses. So they contain a random number of photons, okay? So these are the kind of weak coherent pulses, sends them to Bob. Bob does the same. He measures everything he receives in, you know, a fixed basis, either computational or Hadamard. But now the difference is, straight away, he reports to Alice, you know, in which rounds he actually received something. So he says, okay, in these rounds I received something, let's play these rounds. In these other rounds I received nothing, we're going to discard them. And then obviously Alice now needs to decide whether, you know, the losses are low enough or not. Because if Bob says, look, I missed everything except for a single photon, then she should probably abort, because you cannot get much security out of a single photon. So there's going to be some kind of detection threshold here. In the open phase, same. Bob's agents simultaneously, you know, pass on the results to Alice's agents. And then in the verify phase, Alice's agents verify, but now they allow some errors. So maybe they only need, you know, that the strings are roughly the same. They don't have to be fully consistent with the BB84 states. And so now you ask, okay, so I have these thresholds. There is the kind of the detection threshold, and there is the error threshold. And now the question is, how do you actually choose these thresholds? And well, if you actually want to run the experiment, that's probably the best way to do it. So that's what we did. So you actually run the experiment, and you can estimate the parameters. Because, you know, if Alice sends capital N pulses and Bob reports detecting, you know, N of them, then the ratio is just the detection probability you need for the honest party to succeed. So you do the experiment, you estimate the detection threshold, and then in the open phase, when Bob unveils, you can estimate the Q bar just by, you know, counting the number of errors divided by kind of the total length of the string. So these are really the kind of the crucial parameters of the protocol, the detection probability and the error rate, I mean, for the honest parties. And then you can kind of, you know, you can do your security analysis, and kind of the first step is that asymptotic security is possible if the following inequality holds. And this inequality, you know, contains the detection probability, the Q bar, the mean photon number, and lambda. In this case, lambda is the measure of how complementary the states are. So for BB84, for ideal BB84, it's 15%. And somehow the second step is, you know, you just do finite statistics. So then if you tell me how many rounds you played, I can actually tell you that, you know, the Bob's cheating probability is upper bounded by 10 to the minus 7 or 8, whatever you want. And then you can, you know, you can decide how many rounds you want to play. Okay, so I guess just the last slide. So the asymptotic feasibility can somehow tells you how good the honest devices need to be for you to execute the protocol and for the protocol to be both robust and secure. And I just kind of plotted a couple of things. So this is the kind of the feasible region as a function of the detection probability, the mean photon number, for different values of the Q-bar, just to show you that if you tell me how good your honest equipment is, then I can actually tell you if, you know, if you can get a protocol that's both robust and secure. So these are just kind of a couple of nice plots. Okay, let me hand over to Felix now.
Thank you. Okay, so I want to tell you about the implementation of what Jed presented. Okay, so here's the space-time diagram that Jen presented, and the very first thing that I want to point out is how difficult this is to do on long distances. Okay, there are two challenges. The first one is this part. This is the quantum exchange part. To respect the spirit of the protocol, the quantum data exchange should happen really, really fast. So lots of qubits sent in a big bunch and all detected simultaneously. At least the time for this should be much smaller than the commitment time that is set by the distance between the two agents. Okay, so if you want to do this on a short distance, it's quite challenging. And also, the communication here should happen at the speed of light. And over short distances, you can do it. But if you want to use antipodal points on the surface of the Earth and use, you know, the full degree of freedom that you had, then it becomes quite challenging because you would have to put this quantum station here right at the center of the Earth. Nevertheless, this is doable over short distances, and it's been done recently by the group of Chan Wai Pan, collaborating with Marcos Kirsi, who's here in the audience. They have done the experiment over a distance of about 20 kilometers using free space communication link, and they reach a commitment time of about 30 microseconds. Now, how can we go beyond that? The first thing you want to avoid, if you want to go beyond that, is to have to do the quantum distribution, the quantum part at the center of the Earth. So let's say we put it somewhere on the Earth, and we allow Alice and Bob to do this very slowly. Okay, so we give them the time. Okay, and then Bob is going to measure all the qubits in a given basis. That is random. It's not this commitment yet. Okay, so he just measures everything in that basis, and then he has the time to inform his agents about the results. And Alice can also have the time to inform her agents about the state that she sent. So everything, the stage is set at this point. So this should work. No? Okay. So the stage is set to do the commitment part. So let's say at some given time, both agents can give, both agents of Bob, who's the committer, can give a bit B prime, can reveal a bit B prime to the agents of Alice, and you know they're separated by the distance d. And then, as I recall, the quantum part happened like much in advance, somewhere around here, say. And then this bit is the XOR of the basis in which quantum Bob measured in and the commitment. Okay? And later on, after the commitment time, then the agents can reveal the results as well as the commitment. And then the agents of Alice can backtrack and figure out if this is consistent with the state that she sent. Okay, so she can do verification on the spot. Okay, so now we can take that and go to the playground, which is, it's the longest distance experiment I've ever been working on. So we were fortunate in a way to collaborate with people in Singapore, so we could send them some classical hardware and they could put them here. So the straight line distance is about close to 10,000 kilometers, which yields a commitment time of 15.6 milliseconds. It's close to the maximum you can get, 21.2. If this part would have been just, maybe I think, 600 kilometers east of New Zealand, which is, actually, yeah, maybe the North Pole and the South Pole could be two places that are easily accessible to get to the antipodal points without using a boat or anything like that. Okay, so in Geneva we had the quantum boxes that do the key exchange, and then some classical agents that were just close by. The communication between the quantum boxes and the classical agents is done over the internet. Everything is one-time pan encrypted. Same for Alice and Bob. And here, the communication between these agents is done using FPGAs and a fast comm link. I'll get back to that. Synchronization is done using GPS. Same on the other side here, so in Singapore, but we don't have the quantum boxes there. Okay, so let me tell you about this, the classical agents. It's basically two computers that are synchronized using this GPS here, and then they can communicate using a small optical fiber link. And then the heart is really this FPGA board that's connected to the GPS, so the clock on the board is disciplined by the GPS, and then data can leave or enter through this optical link. And it's correlated with the time that you get in there. And therefore, you can record everything, send the data, and then after check that everything is as it should be. And then we did a bunch of tests to see how precise this is. And on a short time scale, it's, the timing is precise within 10 nanoseconds. So that's good enough for what we need to do. Now, the quantum hardware is this commercial quantum key distribution system by Idé-Quantique. So there should be a bigger wall in between the two here, presumably. And the only thing that connects them is really this this optical fiber here. So I don't have the time to explain all the details to you about how this works, but it's the plug-and-play system. So it's a two-way system, okay? And it suffice to say that Bob is actually sending strong pulses of light to Alice, and this is the container that Alice can actually use to prepare the states that she wants to send. And it comes back, and everything is aligned. It's very easy to work with. So I'm going to have to skip that. The state preparation is done using this phase modulator. So the relative phase here is preparing the states, and then everything comes back. And then the measurement basis is decided by the phase in this device here by Bob, and you can do the device. So the mean number of photons is decided at when the photons actually leave Alice's lab. And this can be controlled with a variable attenuator, and there's lots of procedures to make this work almost seamlessly. The one thing that you certainly have to get rid of, okay, when you want to do bit commitment, is the basis reconciliation. You don't want Alice and Bob say, okay, I prepared in that basis, what about you? Okay, so the only thing that needs to be eliminated is that, and you keep only this is the back reporting, which pulses were actually detected. Okay, and that's very important to do that in advance. Otherwise, there's an easy cheating strategy that you can do. Okay, so in terms of quality, well, you have to choose the mean number of photons properly so that it's not too high, but not too low. If it's too high, it's insecure because of multi-photons. If it's too low, signal-to-noise ratio is too low. So we operated at 0.5%. This is wrong, right? It's a 0.5. I wrote 5%. Okay, I'm gonna have to check this. I think it's 5%. Okay, so then that was giving us a cuber that's actually sitting right here. That's what we see here. So we did here. You see 100 commitments, and that's the distribution of the cuber we observe for each of these commitments involving the detection of 7,000 pulses. So it's never more than 5%, so there are some fluctuations. So that's actually the cutoff that we use for the final statistics analysis. You also have to check for the detection probability. And of course, this can vary over time because the system, the detectors, their efficiency can change, things can get misaligned slightly, or things like that. So if you look at the detection probability, it can fluctuate. And Bob should certainly monitor that once. Yeah. Should certainly monitor that every once in a while. And there's an easy side channel that could be exploited here, because it could be that the detection efficiency in one basis is not the same as the other one. So the only thing that Alice would need to do is to send a couple of pulses and see how many of those pulses Bob claims to have detected. And then she knows in which basis he's measuring. Okay, so we need to compensate for this. And actually, the system was suffering from that. This is the ratio of the detection probability of the least efficient basis over the most efficient basis, and it was around 95. This is the black points you see there. And this can be corrected by having Bob to report, to basically remove some of the detections at random to equalize this, these detection efficiencies. Okay, and in the end, we end up with something that's pretty much equal to one in terms of the ratio. Okay, so the results are this. This is 50 commitments of bit one, seven detections for each commitment. So this is the distribution of the cuber. And what you see here is the security curve that Jed presented, and these are our points. Okay, so among these 50 commitments, one gave us, I mean, the largest PDET, the detection property we observed is this one, and the smallest is this one, so the spread is very small. All of them are well within the secure region, which is this, given by this equation here. And in terms of the cutoff for the finite statistics, we used 5% here, and then 0.2%, and it gives a security parameter of less than 10 to the negative 7. Okay, so it's fairly good in terms of that. Okay, so for the conclusion, so we, I think we're, anyway, opening possibilities for this kind of these kind of primitives in quantum cryptography with two mistrustful parties. So I think that's interesting, and I also think it's fun that we're closing. We're very close to the maximum commitment time that we can achieve on the surface of the Earth, and there are some possibly interesting extensions of that. So maybe it's possible to also extend the commitment time using. We have no idea. Maybe it's possible to have like a constant communication requirement on in order to achieve a sustained commitment, just like in the classical case. And with this, yeah, that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Questions?
There's
one back here.
Thank you. Is there any possible security issue with if you can spoof the GPS receiver?
Oh, yes, certainly. This has been demonstrated by very recently. Okay, so GPSs can be spoofed by university students, so ideally, of course, you know, the clock should be independent. Alice's should all have their own clock that is not relying on something external. Okay, and. Now, there are actually portable atomic clocks, and I'm very glad you asked this question because I prepared a very small slide about that. Now, atomic clocks can be made portable. This is miniature, and then the aging is very small. So over a month, 0.8 milliseconds at most, something like that. This should be smaller than it. That's enough, you know, to run in principle this over a month and without having to change it, to resynchronize your clocks. So, yeah.
Okay, I have another question here.
Hi. So you mentioned in the beginning how there are some practical issues that arise because you're using weak coherent sources instead of single photons. But in quantum key distribution, there's a standard trick to deal with this, which is decoy states. So I'm just wondering why you didn't just choose to do something like this in the setup.
Well, essentially because you don't need to. I think the decoy state method is there to maximize the rate, and we don't worry too much about that because we just need to exchange some bits. And then with that, we get a certain security parameter, and that's enough. It's just, okay, maybe if you want to do bit commitment at gigahertz rate, maybe that could be interesting. But for what we did, it wasn't necessary.
Well, I think we better move on to the next talk. Thanks. Let's thank both speakers again from the